One of the next big elections in Wisconsin is for state Supreme Court. And if recent history is any guide, you wonder if it could be another politically charged election with lots of negative ads and outside money. Justice Pat Roggensack, who's been on the court since 2003, will seek another 10-year term. The election will be April 2nd, and if she has more than one opponent, that primary will be February 19th. Justice Roggensack is our guest now on Up Front. Justice, good to have you back with us.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little bit about what's at stake in this election. From your perspective, what is it?
Well, what is at stake in this election is informing the voters about the qualifications of the candidates who seek the office of Supreme Court Justice. And in my view, this campaign is going to be about experience of the applicants for the job, how their experiences match up with the duties of the job, and also about judicial philosophy.
How would you describe your philosophy?
Well, my philosophy is really quite simple. I believe that courts interpret the laws. They call the balls and the strikes, but they do not write the laws. The Constitution authorizes the legislature to actually write the laws. And we have a tripartite system of government in Wisconsin, and it's important, I think, for a justice to respect the other two branches of government.
Let me ask you about something that was said late in the week. It's by Vince Megna, who has announced that he will be running in this race. He's a lawyer, and he said, it's time to stop the fiction here. He said, I'm a Democrat, I'm a liberal. Pat Roggensack is a Republican. Her campaign's being run by a guy who's long been associated with the Republican Party. What's your response to that?
Well, first of all, the man who is my strategist for my campaign is a friend of mine for 18 years. He's run all my campaigns, and I trust his ethics
and his honesty.
Mm-hmm. Brandon Scholes, right. So whatever affiliations he has in addition to that, he runs my campaign because of our long-standing relationship. I have worked very hard to set up a bipartisan campaign for this election. And though we run nonpartisan, in Wisconsin that really means you have to get identifiable Democrats, identifiable Republicans to support you, and then a lot of people that you really don't know what their identifications are, so that you can show the public that you are trying to be a candidate for all the people, not for some of them.
So you see this very much as a nonpartisan race, and
yes,
yet recent elections, we would probably agree, have seemed very partisan, where you have all this outside money coming in, people are said to be too soft on crime. They sound and look a lot like legislative races, congressional races, and Senate races. Do you think that's going to happen this time around?
You know, it's hard for me to say. I can only tell you that I will run my campaign in the way that I think is appropriate, which is to try to inform the voters about the broad experiences that I bring to this job. You know, I'm the only justice who's ever sat on the Court of Appeals for the state of Wisconsin, and I've helped the court in many ways because of that. I had broad experience as a lawyer on the other side of the bench for 16 years. So the breadth of my experience and the tasks that a Supreme Court justice has to undertake are what the voters should look at, and I'm going to try very hard to put that information before the voters.
Are you concerned that for some this could become almost a single-issue campaign where there would be questions raised about, for example, the court's vote on Act 10. You voted with the majority in saying that you did not think the open meetings law was violated. That for some, that may be the issue in the race. Are you concerned it becomes a one-issue race for some?
Well, I think that you will always have some people that isolate an issue that to them is very significant and very important. And I understand that. But there are a lot of people in the state of Wisconsin, and there are a lot of issues that are important to individual groups, individual people. So I really don't think it will boil down to just an Act 10 discussion.
I want to have you address how the court is perceived by the public, because they see the headlines, they hear stories about a couple of justices literally at each other's throats, and you breaking it up. And there's some people who think it's a court that's dysfunctional and bitterly divided. You've said it is not. But how do you convince the people of Wisconsin that the court is functioning as it should?
Well, I think it's really through interviews like this, if this is aired, we are doing good things for the people of Wisconsin. Do you know that 7-0, for the first time in the history of the state of Wisconsin, the Supreme Court set up a finance committee so they could be careful stewards for the people's money? And our budget for the court system as a whole, it's about $315 million. It's the first time we did this all together. The court also worked in combination with one another to try to get decisions out to people. You know, we accept decisions, we accept cases that we believe are very significant cases, they're very important. But to the individual litigants, they wait every day for our decisions to come down. And we were really pretty slow. I came from the Court of Appeals where the turnaround was quite fast. And I have worked with my colleagues since I've gotten there to speed up the release of opinions. We are working together. I think what happened back in 2011 was really a six-legged mule. It really was not exemplary of the way the court operates within our private conferences, one another, interactions, whether they're in conference or whether they're just in the hallways. You know, Justice Bradley still comes in singing her corny songs, and Justice Prosser still had his tie on always. I kid him, I think he probably wears a tie in the shower. He comes to my house for a barbecue and he's got a tie on. I have blue jeans on. So, you know, those are good people that are working very, very hard for the people of Wisconsin.
Justice Roggensack, we appreciate your time today. Thanks very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Next, I'll have some final thoughts on state election laws.